was a disruption earlier at today's football match between the Raccoon Sharks and the Old. The number of injured is not yet known.
Customer.
Who is this guy?
Damn it! He's unconscious. Are you all right?
What are you doing, sir?
Yeah. Huh. Here's what I'm thinking.
What should I do?
Death is our stock and trade here at Abbott. The final solution? I am one of the few who'll admit that. First it giveth, then it taketh away.
Been here a long time. I don't understand much about this place, but I know your being here ain't no coincidence. This place wants to talk. It needs people like you. Once it gets a hold of you, it won't let you go.
Opening and ending 曲坂本龍一3人の巨匠のコラボレーションによる夢のシネマティックアクションゲームセブンサムライ 20XX。
What's going on? We've brought the men that will save us!
普遍的な魅力で人々を引きつける名作7人の侍をモチーフにしたセブンサムライ 20XX。
Next!
舞台を未来世界に移し展開される重厚なストーリー、切る感覚にこだわった爽快感あふれる機械生命体ヒューマノイドの一団に追われる謎の少女ヒナタを守るために集結する7人の侍たち、世界の命運をかけた戦いが今始まる。幼い頃から剣豪武蔵に剣術の指南を受けてきた主人公、若き侍ナト、謎の女剣士Q、情報通の頼りになる男エイト、ナトの幼馴染ジョディ、あまたの戦を渡り歩いてきた老将官兵衛、歓楽街を取り仕切る用心棒老次、弱き者の味方盗賊達馬、戦うことで自らの存在を明かそうとする侍たちが世界を救うために団結する。
We will not be defeated!
プレイヤーが操作するのは若き侍ナト、好みのプレイスタイルで敵を蹴散らせ。ジャストアタック、ひたすら攻撃することで戦いを有利、敵との間合いを一気に詰め攻撃を決めよう。ジャストガード、タイミングよくボタンを押すことで敵の攻撃をガード、そして相手の体勢を崩し反撃する。ジャストステップ、敵の方向へステップすることで背後に回り込み攻防を瞬時に逆転、後ろから追撃する。それぞれの成功によって連殺タイマーが回復、 100% に達すると発動する。華麗なる二刀流、さまざまな技を駆使して形作られる自分だけのプレイスタイル、無限の可能性がここにある。何のために戦うのか、誰のために戦うのか、自分の強さだけを追い求めていた若き侍が真の侍へと。セブンサムライ 20XX、 この冬君の手に。
あなたが書いた20世紀の未解決事件という特集記事読みました。
私にはまだやることがある。
彼らの名はチームファントム、非合法諜報機関 C に所属するエージェント。数々の危険な局面をくぐり抜けてきた彼らは指令を最優先に実行するプロフェッショナル。 しかし今回の任務には想像をはるかに超える危険が待ち受けていた。スパイアクションアドベンチャーゲーム、スパイフィクション。最悪のミッションが今幕を開ける。
スパイフィクション。
厳重な警戒網を突破して敵地に潜入したのはこの3人。エージェントのシェーラ・クロフォード、作戦参謀のニクラス・ナイトウッド、そしてチームリーダーのビリー・ビショップ。君たちの使命はただ一つ、ミッションを成功させよ。
今回装備してもらったスパイツールの中からごく一部を説明しておこう。まずはラペリングハーネス。通常移動が不可能と思われる状況で使用してほしい。敵地内のセンサーをかわせるよう体勢移動が可能なタイプを用意しておいた。宙吊り状態でも通常通り攻撃できるので安心したまえ。次に光学迷彩システム。スパイス、オクトギアの特殊機能の一つ。光学迷彩機能により装着者を周囲の風景に溶け込ませることができる。壁際などに身を潜め静止していれば下半身から透明化していく。ステルス状態をうまく使いこなしてくれたまえ。続いてスパイダーグリップ。その名の通り雲のように天井に張り付くことが可能となる。針に沿って忍者のように移動することもできるので周囲に身を潜めるものがない時に役立つだろう。もちろんこの状態でも光学迷彩機能は使用可能だ。最後に光学式変装システム。 3DA カメラを使って潜入先で変装データを入手し、そのデータをセレクトすれば体の表面に変装相手の画像を投影することができる。光学的に体の周りに変装相手の映像をまとっている。つまり全身の変装を瞬時に行うことが可能なのだ。
さあファントムよ、殺人ウイルスラダーの秘密を暴き、国際テロ組織エニグマの陰謀を打ち砕け。君たちの成功を期待する。
Back in the hole. Back in the hole.
Spy fiction.
I used to play here all the time. Yeah. Is your leg okay? Does it hurt? It does a little, but I'm fine.Mayu? No, stop! Wait! Mayu!
I'm so sorry.
Hello, I'm Dan G.
Hello, I'm Dan D.
Hi, I'm Joel.
And I'm Aid.
And this is SOCOM 2, the fine, lovely rendered intro from the game that kind of shows that they've spent a little bit more money on it this time round and lavished that bit more attention on it. Better than the first game, basically. A lot better than the first game. Not super perfect, still a little bit rough around the edges looking, but there's more variety in the levels, you do more
stuff. Starts in a brothel, must be good.
Quality, the mark of a good game. Yeah. Team play stuff is kind of the same as last time, I find. I think, for me, the main strengths are the fact that it just looks that bit better, a bit more solid, a bit more confident.
Online and, play is very good still.
Yeah, 16 players online if you've got the broadband stuff. As to whether it's worth buying if you haven't got the broadband stuff, I don't know, because the multiplayer bit is so strong.
The single player is still quite a strong game in its own right. As when we reviewed it, we said that at times it's even more involving than Metal Gear Solid 2, which I find hard to believe, but it is at times true.
Yeah. Cleverly uses the headset, I think, which kind of sucks you into the atmosphere.
Yeah,
all the chatter from your teammates and HQ will come in through directly into your ear.
It's a cracking game. And if you've got online, it's got to be an essential buy, really. It is like the best online thing at the present. So if you're even vaguely interested in running around shooting people, this one does it the best by miles. So I strongly recommend it. We give this 90%, which is crazy indeed. Now this is Castlevania. That's the castle.
And here's the... Hang on, no, that's not going to work, is it?
Yeah, this is PS2 update of classic series, basically. It's been in the offing for a long time.
So is that Simon Belmont, then?
Yeah,
it's Leon Belmont.
I'm coming to get with the program.
Come on.
But, kind of not as lavish as something like Devil May Cry. Not as immediately gorgeous looking. Like, you can see the character here a little bit kind of flat, a little bit not that interesting.
Not that dramatic.
It doesn't look very PlayStation 2, does it?
No.
But I think it's...
It looks okay. Nice. It's very arcadey, very sort of fast to play, and it really kind of like successfully continues what the old 16-bit games were about. If you haven't played the 16-bit games, you won't know what I'm talking about, but it's... Devil May Cry totally ripped it off, basically, and so this is trying to do steal a little bit of its thunder back again by being 3D, running through a big haunted house, hitting things. So, like Devil May Cry, but not as good, which is reflected in our kind of 85% score.
Yeah, it's not exactly the same game as Devil May Cry, but that is all about the shooting. There's sort of more of a slight adventuring element to this. And it's all about the way your weapons expand. And there's good bits like when you jump in between swinging razor blades, which I've seen in millions of games, but it is well done.
Who is it that puts those swinging razor blades in the games? Stop it.
I think there's some really nice touches to this, though, like the way the bosses have all got particular sort of elemental strengths and weaknesses, and you have to use a particular weapon. There's kind of quite a lot of hidden areas and things you have to unlock. You have to revisit the levels at certain times.
I've got a horrible feeling this game's going to be ignored, though, because just to look at it, it just looks so...
Yes.
Yes, well,
Battlestar Galactica. Well, I hated this.
So, me too.
Yeah, basically, you lose at random, and
just monstrously confusing and difficult.
Yeah,
that annoyed me the most about it was the fact that you can't differentiate between your primary objectives and every other single target on your radar.
Oh, well, you actually can, because holding down triangle does that. But at the same time...
Okay, I'll take it.
even if you're doing that, you'll get a mission that's like, protect your wingmen. Except by the time it's gone, protect your wingmen have already gone, no problem, we'll fly off on our own into that squad of Xylon. Oh, my God! And then you've got to replay it, and they're massive levels as well. Back me up on this. They're like, you'll have six objectives. It might take you 20 minutes, and if you mess up the last one, which could take 2 seconds, then you're dead.
You have to do the whole thing all over.
You're so dead all the way through this game. Yeah.
It just looks like Star Wars Starfighter, but just more boring.
Yeah, but also rubbish.
Yeah, just boring and old and rubbish and too late. They've got this brilliant license with all these cool characters on the sidelines, and you don't even see them. And what about the little like monkey dog thing?
Little muffle,
Muffet. Yeah. Thousands of outrageous letters from hardcore battles like Galactica fans, but he's brilliant and he's not in the game.
Because it's based on the
Where's Lieutenant Starbuck?
Series. Yeah. Based on the
I think he wasn't actually alive in this game. Exactly. Where is he? He's in the ship right there flying it.
Yeah.
La, 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 la.
But I loved this. No.
That was a lie.
Rubbish.
It was truly awful.
This is the game we weren't allowed to see or play.
Yes.
Because we could smell it coming.
Featuring.
And it's just crap.
I quite like Terminator Vision though. Look, you can see it. It's just like being a Terminator.
There's some brilliant bits where you're outside in the dark shooting grey stick men.
Even that Terminator Vision, though, I think it's pretty much pointless because it.
Oh, yeah, it's totally pointless.
All it does is say different stuff.
Let's not split hairs. It's pointless.
All it does is differentiate between humans and Terminators, and you know what the difference is because the Terminators are shooting at you.
That's very true. And they're big, grey robots.
Yeah, and that.
But I like this bit, the blow at the police car bit. Because that's the real feeling of being a Terminator. That's all about just storming around. You're a big robot. The police
shooting static cars.
And you're killing stuff, yeah. But I will say, everybody remembers Terminator 3. Well.
Yeah.
And you go, oh, yeah, driving scenes, brilliant. Are there any driving scenes in this? Are there art?
No, these beat-em-up bits are
better than Soul Calibur.
Cack.
It's just rubbish. Mm. It just feels rushed as well. It was rubbish, I think, at every stage of the journey.
Well, from square one, they knew it was probably not going to be a premium quality title. Mm. Hence, it was smuggled past us. And, you know, thank all that's good and decent that it hasn't sold very well. Talking of all that's not good and decent.
The quality games just keep on coming.
This made me want to cry. The thing is, Terminator, I didn't like the film much. I hated the game. This, I love the film, and I hate the game. It's, look at this!
It just looks so robotic.
Yeah.
As opposed to balletic, or whatever you describe it as.
Yeah. Well, the running at the wall, quite nice. Whoa. Look at that, quite nice. But everything else in it, insanely dull. You're just hitting the button, same button again and again. There's special moves, but they're physically almost impossible to do in any kind of proper fight. They're like a little special treat when you find a bloke on his own to pick. Yeah, the rest of it's just
tell us about the desert sections with the boulders.
Yeah. I love the desert sections. I'm not
that
sure
bit in the film with the boulders was good, wasn't it?
Yeah. There's a bit in the desert where there's boulders rolling at you so well that you can't even see them until they've hit you. And then they hit you and hit you and hit you and you die and have to do the whole level again. And, yeah.
Great.
And everybody remembers that bit where Jen accidentally flings herself off a cliff because she's tried to walk in a section of scenery that's open, but the game... Oh, wait. No. There's basically a lot of bits where there's a clear path in front of you, but you're stopped by an invisible wall.
Yeah.
Just... because the programmers
didn't bother
to program that in. Yeah, cheers.
Is it a scrolling beat 'em up then, basically?
Yeah, but rubbish.
Ah, yes.
Mission Impossible.
Oh, hell.
Operation Surma.
Operation...
You get the thing. Yes. All the good Christmas games are out, aren't they?
Yeah. Now,
and this is what's left.
Two terribly timed licenses back to back as well. Because Crouching Tiger film came out years ago. Mm. I was a young man when that film came out. and this... Well, I can't even remember when this film came out.
It was originally called Mission Impossible 2, wasn't it? But it's been so long in development that they've dropped the 2 bit and replaced it with some...
It's possibly the most derived, sort of contrived. It's anything that ends in V-E-D.
Skive?
Yeah. Mission Impossibilized? No, that doesn't work either. But it's just, it's ripped off Splinter Cell to a degree that it's barely... But ripped it off and made it worse.
Barely legal.
Yeah. Yeah. Skirting the boundaries of legality.
Yeah. Yeah. It's but, you know, as we said in our review, a couple of years ago, it would have been okay. But now it just smells of a game that's been in development for ages. And rather than scrapping it and saying, this is rubbish, let's start again, they finished it off and went, oh, bollocks, let's just release it anyway. So, yeah, old hat, not good.
Yeah.
Because in the future, all cars have guns on.
Mine's got one now, I don't know who on it.
Shit, better get myself one.
It's alright, this.
Left out. Yeah, it's just alright.
It's a shameless GTA claim. So wonky.
Yeah.
True.
It's, yeah.
Apart from, you can't get out of the car.
Yeah, you take your Twisted Metal, of course, and your GTA.
But you can't stand on the roof of your car, which is their concession.
Yeah, you're not off it.
No more.
That's it. That's as far as you're going, mate.
I like this jacket. I mean, like GTA, it's full of violence, it's full of bad language. It's got big living cities and stuff going on.
It's an apocalyptic vision of the future.
Brilliant. I love it.
It's
and you know, it's not bad.
Yeah, it's okay. It's all a bit silly and repetitive and sort of kind of pointless.
Ridiculously difficult at times, though, as well.
You get sort of lots of things ganging up on you at once, and when you're
this
trying
bit,
to,
for example, is stupidly hard. You can't move, and they're firing rocket launchers at
yeah.
you.
I was about to say maybe it's because you're standing still, but if you literally
can't move, you're controlling the gun.
Yeah. So while you're shooting one bloke, you're getting it from behind. From another.
Oh, there's nice bits like this where you can just carry a man like a rag doll on the front of your truck.
How come he's allowed out of the car then? What's his excuse?
Yeah. So, yeah, okay. But, I don't know, if you want GTA crossed with Twisted Metal, this is the game for you.
You know, it's the sort of thing people might enjoy while they're waiting for the next GTA.
Perhaps.
Does anyone really care about these games? No. Do they?
Well, EA did a game, did Sledstorm, and they, as the biggest game software publisher in the world, they decided that it was rubbish and pointless and nobody cared. I'm inclined to agree with them, but that hasn't stopped this from surfacing.
It's like a game that a publisher finds at the back of a filing cabinet. Well, it's finished now. You might as well just put it out.
Yeah. The forgotten development team.
But originally it had like a cat on wheels, and they went, well, just change that texture to a sled, possibly.
Yeah.
Well, it could have been a bear. I mean, I'm not differentiating between animals, but it was probably... No, of course, it was always meant to be this. And
it's racing, but you're on...
The worst thing about this is the dreadful, dreadful turbo. Everything slows down when you hit a turbo.
Oh, yeah, it
goes blurry.
It goes a bit matrixy and slower, which in a racing game is just is wrong.
Yeah, a bit strange. And when you're in multiplayer, if one person hits the turbo, then the other person's screen goes blurry as well, which is a bit odd.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it's a bit rubbish, really.
What can you say? I mean,
Flaming Hoops, freak style. Other coloured hoops, SSX.
Well,
it's just wearing its...
Even jump colouring.
Yeah, jump SSX. Gradient colourings.
Jesus.
It's like a man who lives in a snowy place has taken SSX and coded it in his bedroom and dropped it in a filing cabinet deliberately to be found.
Wise words. Oh, curse my eye of Isis. This is absolutely shocking. I hated this. It's not as bad as you think. One thing I will say, it does stink of renderware. Is the software thing that lets developers make better games than they could normally do. The look of it is very, very. You can see the way the character models are put together and the way they move and that. It's just think, yeah, it's very renderware. It's just awful. It's set in 18 something or other.
Oh, Christ.
And it starts off in a big deserted, dusty old museum with nothing in it. And you just, a quarter of an hour in, you wanted to take your own life. It's just rubbish.
Is there any element of Frenchness in this game's development?
I think there might be. There's, that's always the... we don't want to diss a whole country, but, yeah, it's always a kiss of death for video games.
Well, I don't want to diss a whole country, but basically, games with Egypt in them, always rubbish.
Oh, no, come on.
Mummy First Returns, Tomb Raider. Rubbish. First Tomb Raider, well, rubbish now.
Yeah, yeah, take that, Egypt games.
That other one in Egypt, you know, the one where you had to click on the walls and the scarabs and they were... you know the one I mean.
Yeah, the really camp mummy. Yeah.
Rubbish.
I can't remember the name of that either, but that was pretty bad.
It's just basically survival horror by numbers, isn't it?
Yeah,
it doesn't do anything to you.
There's an awful lot of walking about, finding the keys that open the doors, and then behind that door there's another key. And then you bump into a character who... talks drivel really slowly, and then you walk into another room and there's this slow motion puppet to kill, and God, Jesus, that's about it.
Myth 3, The Sands of Time, that's what it's called, and games set in history, rubbish, basically. Other than,
any game that puts you, has you wearing a cravat is it's not good.
It's not right, is it?
No, this is about as exciting as it gets, and
mummies that spew at you.
Yeah, it's
barely visible or exciting.
Yep. Hello, it's The Sims.
Yes, in their outfits.
Yeah. They've improved the create a character, make your own likeness thing considerably, but it's still not good enough.
It's just still a bit rubbish if you want to create an accurate self.
If you look at something like WWE, SmackDown and stuff, that's got much, much
new
better.
New Tiger Woods golf face creator, amazing. Tony Hawk's actual face.
Yeah. Imagine that.
That's going to be the next step for this, then.
Mm.
But, so they've improved that bit, and as far as game modes go, it's a lot more crazy. There's a lot more crazy stuff to unlock as you play. Makes the first game look a bit boring and repetitive, rather like the PC games were. So they kind of like ramped it up and made it to you do
your,
more
your character
interesting
can
stuff.
Go on his little thing to visit places like Club Rub, where you just, you know, you dance about and you like to snog people, don't you?
Yeah.
Oh, you can get girls to snog now as well. Very exciting for certain people.
Ooh. Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Sorry. Those people.
Yeah. So there's a lot more careers this time as well, is there?
Yeah, there's this whole thing about you can live as a rock star, and, you know, I don't think it sort of fully lives up to its promise, really, because I imagined it to be a lot crazier and inventive than it actually was.
I think it's very much the craziness of a man with a "you don't have to be mad to work here, but it helps" sticker on his desk.
Homer Simpson tie.
It's all, yeah. It's all like, oh, look, yeah, we've one of the career paths is mad scientist. Oh, crazy, yeah. But I don't give monkeys about this, to be honest. I have enough trouble making friends and not pissing myself in real life.
Yeah, that's right. And I've seen you on your moped. Rubbish. Crash every time.
Everyone's favourite specky wizard.
look at him, he's lovable.
Oh.
Lovable.
Good old Robbie Coltrane. Brilliant.
This is
this shameless cash in or what?
Yeah, pretty much. It's okay. People are going to forgive it because it's got Potter in it. And the kids who get this are just going to run around this first level and not play the game properly and just get kicks out of being Harry Potter. They might as well just create a big Hogwarts and have lots of things, switches to pull, things to mess about with, and just have Harry Potter, instead of trying to make a kind of like a platformy episodic kind of game where you unlock stuff and in the conventional sense the game continues and changes. They might as well just have this big huge playground of
Is that coming back to what you heard?
Yeah.
That young children play this game and just want to be Harry Potter in the sense of just running around in circles going wee wee and then not actually wanting to do anything.
Yeah, that's quite
yeah.
They might as well do that, because if you try and play the game properly, it's not a very good game. And if you just try and run about and pretend that you how a 7-year-old would play it, there's not enough interesting stuff to do.
Problem with that is, though, you know what a beating we give that and go, where's the game, blah yeah. blah blah. Unless they call it like Harry Potter's playroom,
yeah,
where he just uses spells on blocks.
He just does stuff.
It's like a big physics demo or something.
Yeah, runs around Hogwarts, talks to people and does magic spells.
Press circle.
Just do that.
Wee, wee, wee.
Plays a bit of Quidditch. Oh, they've already made a game about that.
Yuck!
Yeah.
You could play Quidditch on the PS2 in his room. It'd be like that double virtual reality.
We won't even have a pop at EA for this is the same game twice. Basically, they've released this on PS1 and then this is a PS2
update. No one's making you buy it.
No.
Dynasty Tic Tacs.
It's the most confusing game in the world.
We have a long history of liking the a bit of Dynasty and the Mag. I quite like the last one. Was it number 3 or number 4? You lose track.
Number 4.
Many.
Last game was number 4, yeah.
That's very good.
This is a strategy spin-off.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of doing what Kessen did, but it's more accessible and nicer than Kessen.
It's very good at what it does, but for most people, seeing the word 6-5-3 defeated on screen just makes you think.
Combo 2!
Or was it Combo 11?
Yeah. Mm.
It's good. You know who you are. If you watch BBC Two's Time Commanders...
Oh, that's a horrible withering dismissal of people.
This may appeal.
Yeah.
That's the closest thing we got.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But with more.
It's extremely
squares.
Niche, isn't it? But it's got appeal for people who are into that kind of thing.
Yeah. Wherever they are.
337-1 defeated, that's an even scarier number.
Still, we should applaud it for being different anyway.
Yes, I applaud it for being different. As long as I never have to play it.
Yes.
It's surprising that it's coming out over here, actually. It's one of those sort of things where I think they're brave and in releasing it, and that's a good thing. So I hope it finds great success.
Well, it's not as if it's against great competitors. So, a title which is so easily it's accomplished, it's tactical, it gives you what you'd want from this game, and in that respect, it's well worth buying 6-8-1 defeated.
Some sort of
it's Shatman,
as he likes to be called. Yeah,
that's fair.
As he should be called.
It really gets me down, Batman games, because I'm all
just think how Batman feels. Oh, why are all my games crap?
I bet he doesn't care. He's too busy
counting the money,
learning to fingerprint.
There's no wonder he's so bitter and twisted.
Batman,
I mean, that's for sure.
Like computer games. I'll tell you that now.
So who's my parents? Know this. It's one of the things you might think.
That's not something you joke about, though.
No, okay, sorry, that's awful.
Anyway,
but he's also not real.
Batman, rubbish.
Yeah, this is extremely basic.
Is it better than Vengeance, Dark Vengeance?
No.
Yeah.
It's running down a corridor, hitting people that run out of doorways.
That sounds better than Dark Vengeance.
That's all it is.
Whoever's playing is getting a lot of fares.
That'd be me, I think.
I don't know what's better than fair.
Fair to middling.
Fair. Yeah, I think you've pretty much seen it.
Good.
Yeah, fair.
Do you get any bat gadgets, like the batarang or the bat
copter?
Yes, no, nothing of that ilk.
It's just so basic, it's depressing.
It was another smuggle game as well. It just arrived after it was already in the shops.
Good.
Boo. Rubbish.
ambushed by the Red. This, on the other hand, brilliant.
Thank God.
Baldur's Gate, Dark Alliance 2. Great.
But you've played this a lot, haven't you? This is
fantastic. It's basically Gauntlet.
Yeah.
It's button bashing, really, when it boils down to it. But what's so clever about it is it's so engrossing. There's so much going on that you forget. Really, you quickly forget that you're actually just whacking buttons. There's so much treasure to find, so many skills to upgrade your character with, so many different levels, you know. And the co-op mode's superb. Really, really good.
I'm tempted to say that it looks good. At this particular moment, it's not looking that dramatic, but the angle of the camera and the animation of everything just looks... It all works really, really well.
I think it's lovely looking.
Yeah.
Wait till you see the water.
Yeah, there's some nice bits.
Yeah, it's not that lovely looking. It's lovely looking enough to tempt you to have a little go at it, I think. And I still probably wouldn't have a little go at it. I'm really naive when it comes to this sort of thing.
I guess, yeah, I mean, you're going to find it difficult to get into it, I think, if you're not into the kind of fantasy setting, but, you know, Dungeons and Dragons.
It's a good mix, I think, because it's got loads of action stuff in it, and yet it's still got loads of upgrade-y and exploration kind of thing. So I'd never describe it as particularly beardy at all. Really,
they've been quite clever about the way they've made it console friendly.
Yeah, the actual process of playing the game, like here, it's almost like kind of shoot 'em up, really. You're kind of running about shooting and hacking and slashing. But yeah, there's an awful lot of stuff to discover and people to talk to, and that's very good.
Stuff. Get it.
I'll see you well rewarded upon my return to Baldur's Gate.
This is Forbidden Siren, currently out in Japan, coming to the UK soon, courtesy of Sony. Done by some fellas that formerly did Silent Hill, hence it being a bloke in the dark with a torch all over again. Mm. Different in that you use the right analog stick to tune your mind into the minds of other people wandering about the level and sort of seeing through their eyes. Very clever, but... let down by the fact that the levels are quite small, and once you've sort of played through them as a couple of people, you've really kind of seen everything that there is to see. So you start feeling like you're literally retreading the same thing, going to the same places and doing similar things, but not big.
Scary?
Well, is any video game scary these days, you know?
I just about crap my pants in Manhunt.
Manhunt's different, yeah, because Manhunt does get you on a quite an interesting level. But, that's the sort of the new benchmark for scariness.
Just sort of tense again and atmospheric, I think.
Yeah.
The fact you can't really kill the guys who are coming at you, just sort of put them down for a little bit.
Is a bit rubbish.
Yeah, but it creates the tension.
Garganto.
久しぶりだな。
絶対合わせん。
I deduced the mission was successful.
All of the nanobots were destroyed.Except for one, courtesy of MI6 and James Bond.
How ironic. Bond has now planted the seeds for his own destruction. Soon enough, the world will know and fear the name Nikolai Diavel.
You'll have everything you desire.
Yes, Katya. Everything or nothing.
Stay for a drive. Why don't you show me the way?
Mission that I am particularly proud of, 007. You're not afraid of spiders, are you?
First, we take over Russia. Then we unleash our little nanobots on the world.
You first.
戦国。鬼の力宿りし者の不と狂気満ちたる幻魔との戦いはその幕を下ろしたかに見えた。がしかし、
General, the wrong way, remember?
Cover me! I'm going here! Here's your new toy, Alec. The other kids will be so jealous, at least the ones you don't blow away first. It's got more firepower than you can shake a third world dictatorship at. That may sound stylish, but if you ask me, this car really needs a lady's touch. And no offense to your friend, but the AI could use a few adjustments.
Amongst you will take up the sword, the staff, the hammer, and drive this scourge from our land. If there be any who would lay down their life for the glory of Faedwar, for the defense of Norrath, then speak now. Ahead will not be an easy one. You may think the enemy nothing more than a rabble of ill-disciplined orcs and goblins. Come on.
Who amongst you will...
Things in driver one that don't get used, and they go into driver two, and then driver two you start realizing all sorts of little things that you might want to do with it, and some of those go into driver three. Suddenly driver three doesn't pop into your head. It's one of those things that's a constantly evolving thing, and you know, there's ideas for driver four, I suppose, already. It's like the same as any franchise, really. You constantly have a lot of material to draw from. It's considerable, really, but it's a platform change as well. So you've got all sorts of changes in technology, you know, the physics and the collisions and so on that we can do in Driver 3, far more advanced than anything that we could do in Driver 1 or Driver 2, because that was on PlayStation 1. The game has evolved, but the game tends to, you know, the first game you could only drive one car, the second game you could get out of the car and you could steal other cars and use whatever cars. Now you can get out of the car and steal an even greater range of cars. You also have guns and so on. The realism of the physics engine gives us that ability to make just simply tearing around the city and doing donuts and crashing into things and destroying your car and picking another car and doing the same with that and picking up cops and so on just becomes fun even without a mission. So it just helps us, because you've won half the battle before you've even designed the mission side of the game. You know, if the game had really crap handling and it felt horrible and the thing had no, you know, you couldn't slide the car and it had no feel to it, the missions would have to be fantastic to make the experience fun, as we try to do it the other way around. We have a system where people can do various things, such as, you know, walking around, obviously, but standing, chatting, sitting down at tables and standing up again. Cars can go off and do things, like, for example, you might see a car pull into a gas station. You know, things that they're not actually important to a mission, they're just the surrounding buzz of the city. And one of the first things we did with Driver was to actually get some of that across, in that the cars stopped at the traffic lights when they were red, and then they turn green and they'd be indicating as well, and then they go off in the direction they were indicating. And you know, back in the days of Driver 1, that was all really new stuff, and it was you could just park up in a lay-by and just sit there and watch it, and it was quite entertaining just to watch it for a little while. The missions are set up so that you have to drive, say, from the city. You can choose whichever way you go. Because you have an overhead map, you can see on that overhead map what the quickest route is. But as you gain experience in the game, then you can, you know that one road might be faster than another road because it's wider, or there's less traffic, or less obstructions, or whatever. So there'll be certain things in there in terms of things that may always be part of the scenery that might form part of a stunt. But it's not like Stunt Man, the game, where we have a sequence of events that's all very, very carefully timed to create an action sequence. The advantage, I suppose, on the other hand, is that you get certain little moments that might never happen again, of just certain situations that get set up with cars just in front of you or just swerving or whatever, that are very unpredictable because of the nature of the game and the random layout of the city. The missions are not only possible to be solved in one way, and we've tried to free it up and give you a little bit more use of your imagination for how you might want to solve those things. You can make a mission very easy for yourself, or you make it very difficult, but it means that there's some value also in just playing a mission again and just trying a different way. It's not always just about persevering one particular track. The way that we did it in Driver was that rotating map with an arrow pointing to the place that you have to get to. You know, you can see that, and you're really left in no doubt. And when you get there in Driver, we had an arrow that would point to where you had to stop. It all depends what you have to do in the mission, but it's so irritating in a game when you arrive somewhere and you think, well, I just don't know how to finish this mission. Not because it's too hard, but because I actually don't know what to do. We suffered a little bit from it in Driver 1, actually, but we did manage to solve most of those problems in Driver 2. So just by being clear on the indicator, really. The car starts off, if you pick just a random car off the street, it has 100% undamaged, and as you smash the car up, eventually smoke starts pouring out of it and everything. But I still think there's something to be said for being able to see how close to being on its last legs there is, and the same with Tanner as well. Sometimes it can be too vague, I think, if you just rely on the smoke coming out or him limping or whatever. So we just want to be quite clear about how much more energy the guy has before he keels over. The guns themselves are very sort of fun guns, basically. They're like, we're not watching the ammunition, we're not keeping a close eye on every last bullet. It's not a stealthy game, it's not a sniper type of carefully picking off people whilst using the minimum number of bullets. You know, the whole idea is a bit like Matrix, the movie. You know, you walk in there with two Mach-10 machine guns and just spray the place with bullets, and they run out of bullets, you just chuck them away and get another couple of guns and do the same again. So that's the general approach that we've got to it. We've always been known in the past for the amount of destruction and damage that you can do to cars and cars in the environment. And what we want to do is carry that level of destructive realism into the internal buildings as well. Just so that you can feel, you can walk into a room and with a machine gun, spray the room with bullets and actually feel like you've done some real physical damage to the room. There will be occasions where doing something in a room, you know, has an effect on a mission and can make something either easier or harder, depending on what you do. There are multiple exits from rooms or multiple entrances from rooms, but you don't necessarily know which is the best entrance. And there are also sort of hidden situations where it requires you to possibly move something, possibly with another vehicle, those sorts of things where you just have to think for a bit. Driver really is a car chase game. Probably around about 70% of your time actually will be spent driving and being chased and chasing, and the remainder walking around. The way we did Driver 1 originally was you had a telephone answering machine that gave you a choice of two or three missions, and then eventually you would come back to a story element. The problem is, when you do it like that, is that a lot of those missions end up being not directly related to the story. So your motivation for completing them is not as high as if you really knew, you know, what you were trying to achieve and why you were trying to achieve it. So what we've gone for is to try and get that the sort of emotional involvement that you can't get if you end up saying there's this basic story running through that you have to eventually catch some guy, for example, but oh, whilst you're at it, just, you know, go and collect this, will you, for this other character, and go and shoot this guy who's, you know, just irritating this other guy. And the characters themselves are not really involved in the story too much. It's just a different approach, really, that we changed between Driver 1 and Driver 2. If you enjoyed the sort of driving experience that you got in Driver 1 and Driver 2 in terms of the look of creating a car chase and producing something that's so close to watching a real movie car chase, then that's something that you get in Driver 3, on the added performance of the PlayStation 2 and Xbox and so on. And I don't see any reason for making Driver into a game where turning it into a getaway or turning it into a Vice City. I think we'll always just focus on what we're or what Driver was originally about, which was the movie car chase element. Driver 1 stands up still quite well. You can sit down and play Driver, you know, rag around the streets, fun of the feel of the vehicles and what have you, and smashing up the vehicles and the realism with how we smash them up because of the physics engine, the kind of stuff that we can do when you destroy a vehicle is something that I don't think you see in either of those two games.
Spy Hunter was one of the games that really grabbed me. There were only a few games back then that, you know, you really pumped quarters into, and Spy Hunter was one of those.
No, at the time that I played the game, I didn't know what, you know, a successful video game was. I just knew what video games I liked, and that was one of the ones that I remember in college as being a game that I had really, really gotten into.
Spy Hunter was something that, at that particular moment in time, I had a tremendous amount of passion for. I can visualize, you know, the plane trip from Tokyo back, thinking, okay, we've got to make, you know, I've got to make this car game. It was just seemed like a real natural thing. Let's do a car game. Let's make it a car with weapons.
You know, I think what really grabs me about Spy Hunter is the music.
Whenever you got weapons, you got music, and when the Peter Gunn theme ran out, you'd get these riffs. And so, you know, if you've ever seen a really good Spy Hunter player, he gets a lot of these jazz riffs that go in between that hook together the Peter Gunn theme. The G6155 CIA Prototype Interceptor was the name of the car, and it was my initial and my birthday, 6155. It was a difficult exercise to determine what this car was going to look like, but the biggest frustration was that in a top view driving game with two 32 by 32 pixel picture blocks stacked together to represent this car, forget about it. You know, it's a white blob with, you know, with some stripes.
I think one of the things that people really love about the game is your ability to transform into different vehicles.
In something like a vehicle, if that vehicle is going to transform, I want the transformation to be feasible.
To me, one of the coolest things was getting into the weapons van to reload.
If you run out of ammunition, I need a real event that's going to replenish your ammunition.
It offered you this unlimited experience where you could just keep going, and it never really felt like it finished, which was totally unique for its time. And Spy Hunter had this wonderful sit-down, very large cabinet that would really consume the player, and the controls were good. It had a very futuristic type steering wheel control mechanism.
And when I was doing the controls, I sculpted those grips that became, you know, now they've been used on a bazillion games. They're sort of a coin-op industry standard.
To me, Spy Hunter was a special game because it had a completely different play mechanic that was really simple, yet completely original.
I think Spy Hunter, you know, being the first sort of racing combat game, I think it sort of helped define a genre that's pretty popular now.
Well, I think, you know, Spy Hunter as an arcade game would be in the top 10 arcade games of all time.
The coolest thing was, you know, hey, I got music, I got a couple of cars, and I've got a stack of lights. You know, I got every weapon, I got some of them twice, and so I'm loaded for bear, I'm on the road, bring them on. And you know, it was great fun.
We wanted to make a great action combat driving game without being shackled by the design of the original. So it's basically a game that's inspired by Spy Hunter versus, you know, bringing the old Spy Hunter and everything that, you know, it had to the next-gen consoles.
As the game evolved in modern day, you need something with, you know, a lot more depth. And so you really need Nostra, and you need all that stuff.
First kind of coat of paint or pass in terms of design, if you will, was to replicate not the gameplay identically, but replicate what I would call the gameplay experience, meaning how playing the game made you feel.
We set out to make a great game that lived on its own and brought all the Spy Hunter elements into it, and I think that's why it sort of succeeded on its own.
I think E3 2001, when we introduced the product and let everybody take a look at what we were doing, that was the turning point, when they realized that we weren't just using Spy Hunter as a crutch.
You know, we did the right thing, we took the right steps to make it great, and I think that people, you know, the game magazines and the fans, the people that bought the game really saw that.
Everybody has kind of their moment when you really realize you're there. And for me, it was standing in the conference room upstairs at the Midway meeting, looking out of this glass window, looking down on the Midway booth and seeing a line of 10 people waiting to play Spy Hunter and seeing the smiles on their faces. We approached Spy Hunter 2 with a very fresh perspective.
One of the first things we talked about is, like, you know, what can we add to the existing play mechanic that we really like, that everybody seemed to really enjoy, to sort of bring it to the next level.
There were a number of aspects of the game that I didn't feel fulfilled their full potential.
We also wanted to just give the player more options. One of the things that we found was that people felt that the game was pretty short.
It was one of those circumstances that by the time you finally figure it all out and you have somewhat of a formula to blow out further, you have to finish it.
We also wanted to allow the player to have more choices to make throughout the game. Instead of just sort of buying a ticket and taking him on a ride for the entire game, we wanted to give the player more choices to make throughout the game.
Moving into Spy Hunter 2, one of the dreams on the wish list, if you will, was to be able to replicate in 3D what was done with the original Spy Hunter. We've done that. We have the ability to dynamically generate pieces of track.
So we think it's kind of cool and nostalgic. It allowed us to create an environment in which you're able to continually play and keep driving down this road that never seems to end.
Due to the fact that it's random, you don't know what's coming next.
And we're using this for our boss areas where you'll want to do battle with this boss on an endless road until the boss is destroyed.
For example, one of the boss battles is a train, and you have to continue to blow parts off of this train.
Each car of the train has sort of its own attack style. It'll also launch vehicles at you to sort of disrupt your attack.
And until you complete this boss battle and take out this train, they're going to continue to spawn track pieces and you're going to continue to go on.
You know, I like the introduction of a female character. I think that's great.
And she rides a motorcycle. And it's an incredible motorcycle that does justice to her character.
She's a new IES agent that was recruited. The player, as Alec, doesn't know much about her.
And there's quite a bit of interplay that goes on between the proverbial female agent and Alec's sex.
Spy Hunter is really all about the car and what that car can do and the sort of cool factor of the Interceptor. I think that's what the whole franchise is sort of based around, is the car.
The 8155 Interceptor is the next iteration in the series from the engineering department at IES.
Well, this time around, the car can transform into a off-road vehicle. It can also transform into a snowmobile. You can choose to go into escape cycle mode, blow the pieces off the Interceptor, and use those as a projectile weapon, and then, you know, hit the gun and escape.
Had a great time making Spy Hunter. It was something that, you know, was pure. It was something we really wanted to do, and I think that's how you end up with stuff like that. I think you end up with great stuff when you have fun making it.
ユーガルト様が警護されているはずです。 Kicks you a stand up.
Mm-hmm.